This is a Mucube. It stretches infinitely in every direction, though of course no picture can show infinity. What you're seeing is just a fragment, but it's enough to reveal the pattern. Every face is a square, every edge is shared by exactly two faces, and every vertex connects six squares in a neat, repeating pattern. It may not look like any polyhedron you've seen before, but in a very real sense, it is a polyhedron, one that fills all of space. To build it, start with an infinite chessboard with half the squares missing, an endless sheet of alternating squares. Now copy it upwards and downwards, stacking layer upon layer, all perfectly aligned. Next, add another set of chessboards, vertical this time, facing left and right. And finally, a third set, front to back. The result is a structure of interlocking sheets of squares. This, although infinite, is a valid polyhedron. And more than that, it's a regular polyhedron. Every face identical, every edge identical, every vertex the same, with six squares meeting at each. What you see here is, of course, just part of a Mucube. A real one extends endlessly in all directions, filling all of space, so it cannot be observed from the outside because it has no outside. The only true way to experience it is from within. Let's dive in. It's full of corridors, each one stretches infinitely. At regular intersections you can turn, left or right, up or down, and discover new corridors, all endless. The corridors are all the same. The walls are indistinguishable. Every square is identical. You can go as far as you like in any direction. It's easy to get lost because every place looks like every other, which is, of course, inevitable in a regular polyhedron. But there's something strange going on. Although you can move as far as you like in any direction, if you explore long enough, you'll start to notice that some places are unreachable. Take the cell behind the walls in front of us, for example. You can go all around it, but it's walled off on all sides. You can't enter from above or below either. Those approach points are unreachable too. Conventional polyhedra divide space into an inside and an outside, but the Mucube divides space into two identical, impossibly complex, intertwined parts. These parts are neither inside nor outside, two parallel worlds. Let's look at a vertex. Six squares meet here, leaning alternately forward and back. If you join points on the edges around the vertex, you get the vertex figure. This is what you get, a skew polygon. Some might hesitate to call it a polygon at all. Polygons are supposed to be flat. But whatever this is, it's perfectly regular. All the edges are the same, and all the angles too. This shape is the gateway to polyhedra far stranger than even the Mucube, ones I'll be covering in future videos. Another way to look at the Mucube is simply as a stack of cubes with half the faces taken away, provided of course you can work out which ones to remove. This gives a clue to finding related polyhedra. Truncated octahedra can also fill space perfectly, with two hexagons and one square at each edge. Remove the squares and you get this, the Muoctahedron. This has four hexagons at each vertex, joined in an up and down fashion, and, if extended to infinity, it's another regular polyhedron. Inside, you find a series of chambers, each with six square portals into more chambers in every direction, continuing endlessly. The Muoctahedron also divides space into two intertwined parts, in a similar fashion to the Mucube, having an identical set of chambers always just out of reach. Four faces surround each vertex, so the vertex figure is this shape, a skew square, another regular skew polygon, with its characteristic up and down vertices. If you look at all faces in a single plane, you'll find that they form this pattern, regularly spaced hexagons. This is in fact a uniform tessellation of hexagons and triangles, with triangles and alternate hexagons removed, akin to the way Mucube planes are square tessellations with half the squares removed. If you place a dot at the centre of each hexagon in the muoctahedron and connect them the right way, you get a Mucube. In this sense, the two are dual to each other, though in this weird world, it's hard to say what the word dual really means. But do the same in reverse, join the face centres of a Mucube, and you get back the muoctahedron you started with, so there's certainly a close connection between the two. The last member of the family is the Mutetrahedron. This time, we start with a solid tessellation of tetrahedra and truncated tetrahedra. Removing the triangles leaves the Mutetrahedron, an object with six hexagons around each vertex. Again, we have infinite corridors, but this time they are triangular and run in multiple different directions, as shown. Taking a journey through one corridor reveals a more complex structure than the Mucube or Muoctahedron. The corridor skirts along the edge of each chamber. The chambers themselves are not adjacent to each other, but are separated by open tetrahedral crossroads, where corridors intersect in the other five directions. The Mucube is all corridors, and the Muoctahedron all chambers, but the Mutetrahedron combines both and feels more open, harder to grasp as a whole. A look round this chamber, for example, reveals the other exits and gives a hint of the complexity beyond. And again, the faces form a single intricate surface that divides all space into two. With six hexagons around each vertex, the vertex figure is a skew hexagon. This is similar to the vertex figure of the Mucube, but has different angles. The alternate construction is from hexagon triangle plane tessellations, with just the triangles removed, similar to the Muoctahedron construction, but with the hexagons closer together. Four sets of these are required. And just as the platonic tetrahedron is self-dual, the Mutetrahedron is dual to another Mutetrahedron, if we construct the dual by connecting face centres again. The Petrie-Coxeter Polyhedra are named after their discoverers, John Petrie and Donald Coxeter, who called them sponges. As infinite regular polyhedra with skew vertex figures, they belong to a larger family of regular skew aperahedra. But do they really count as regular polyhedra? They certainly meet the usual conditions: regular faces, identical edges, and identical vertices. The only question is whether infinite polyhedra should be allowed at all. Normally, only these nine are considered regular polyhedra. But if you do include the Petrie-Coxeter polyhedra, it's the first step into a larger, stranger world of many more regular shapes, which I shall be exploring further. That's all for this video. If you enjoyed it, please give it a like and consider subscribing for more polyhedral content. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.